Good evening, my brother, my sister, my family in Christ Jesus. How are you?
Well.
Good. I would like to say I'm always, always, always fun because Jesus Christ. Amen. Good. Praise Lord. So this is the first evening of our revival meeting, and the topic of tonight is Open My Heart. Yeah. This topic is based on the text from Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, which is the first letter of love that Jesus for his church, for his people. Dear brothers and sisters, I feel so blessed because this topic is very, very helpful and need message in this period, in this challenging time. Praise the Lord. So, before the beginning of our revival meeting tonight, let's have a pray first. Let's have a pray. Lord, we thank you for such a beautiful moment. We come to you, Holy Spirit. We need your power. Dear Jesus, let us focus on you alone. Be with us. May everybody's heart be touched by you. Use this place. Use this union. Use your message. We pray in Jesus' wonderful, precious name. Amen. So, the first, we will have do some warm-up. So we have play again. The game name is, we want to ask you to guess what sound it is. So let's hear to the video. That's video from YouTube. So there are a lot of music instruments, because God is love and God is the beauty. So I would like to play music instruments when I was in my childhood. But you know, in China at that time, most people are very, very poor. For my family, we cannot even to afford a piano. My father wanted to buy a violin for me. That violin only cost $1. $1 violin. But I cannot learn how to play violin because I cannot find a violin teacher. So, you know, but when my family came to the United States, I think our kids are so blessed. They play piano, they play violin, they play cello. But I think everybody, when we're in heaven, we can play many, many beautiful instruments, as many as you want to play. Amen? So let's guess the sounds. So what kind of music instruments? Wonderful. Yeah, it's church organ. Good. I love this song. It can make you calm down. Yeah, good. So in a second. Yeah, it's church organ, yes. Anybody can guess? Yeah, good. It's champong. It's not champered. Yeah, let's hear. So just let it play. It's strange. So when I was a child, I think it's so strange instruments. What's this? Something like a bell. Yeah, it's called bell. It's called bell. It's called bell. It's a very strange song. What? Violin, yes. Yeah, violin is so beautiful. People would say violin is the queen of music instruments. And the piano is the king. Piano is the king of music instruments. Okay, let's stop, Jose. So tonight, yes, I think good. all of us have a very clear, function very well ear. So tonight, I want to use this gift to listen to the voice of who? Of Jesus. Because he has his wonderful view in his last letters. Praise God. So then we'll come to Thanksgiving. So I would invite my team, Caleb, team member. Are you ready, Caleb? Are you ready? Okay, I will invite Caleb to read the text for us. Lead us pray.
Okay, I will be leading the praising part, the Thanksgiving part. The verse I have today is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 to 18. It says, rejoice always, always. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And I will read in Chinese as well. 帖撒罗尼迦前书5章16到18节，要常常喜乐，不住的祷告，凡事谢恩，因为这是上帝在基督耶稣里向你们所定的旨意。 This morning.When I was working, my boss shared, we will also share something similar. We were talking about faith. We were talking about, if you're saying you have faith, that means it doesn't mean you just sit there and pray. At the same time, you have to step forward. When you step forward, then you can know what's the plan that God has given to you. And it might be a,plan that has a door closed, or maybe have a door opens. But whenever the door is closed or open, you always have to give the thanks God, because it's still a God's leading. And from the verse we have seen that in order to happy, to have the rejoice in God, we have to keep praying so we can keep our faith and doing what we are doing. So now we will need two to three people together to pray together. Pray in Thanksgiving.
Amen. So let's turn to Psalm 103, verses 1 to 9. Psalm 103, verses 1 to 9. And he says, Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your disease, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with love kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He may know his way to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. And I will also read from the Chinese version. 我的心啊，你要称颂耶和华，凡在我里面的也要称颂他的圣名。我的心啊，你要称颂耶和华，不可忘记他的一切恩惠。他赦免你的一切罪孽，医治你的一切疾病，他救赎你的罪，脱离死亡，以仁爱和慈悲为你的冠冕。他用美物使你所愿的得以知足，以致你如因返老还童。耶和华施行公义，为一切受屈的人伸冤。他使摩西知道他的法则，叫以色列人晓得他的作为。耶和华有怜悯，有恩典，不轻易发怒，且有丰盛的慈爱。他不长久责备，也不永远怀怒。So this verse says that Jesus is merciful, he's forgiving, slow to anger, and he promised us that he will renew our life. So recently we were studying the book of Daniel at school, and then we were studying the prophecies and the sanctuary. And then from those things, I can really feel that Jesus' love for us and his plan for salvation for every one of us. So tonight, I want to invite you guys to get into a group of 2 to 3 people and then to just pray and praise God for his goodness.
Then we come to confession part. I would invite everybody to open your Bible, Psalm chapter 51, Psalm chapter 51, verse 10. Psalm chapter 51, verse 10. If you got it, just say amen. Amen. Praise God. Okay, let's read together. From 10 to 12. Okay. Create in me a clear heart, O Lord, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore upon me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with your free spirit. I like this text very much. It tells us a story about King David when the prophet Nathan came to him after he committed adultery with other people's wife. So it's a big sin. It's a shame for the king and for the Israel people. So when Nathan told David a story and David came to realize how sinful he is, so he turned back to God and he wrote this song. So I think God cherish not authority, not the power, not the property. God cherish everyone's heart, a heart of confession. So I like this. Create in me a clean heart. Put a new and right spirit within me. So I want this prayer should be everyone's prayer in this union. So before that, I want to show you a very inspiring video about the prayer. I just got it from a pastor from California this afternoon, but I think I cannot wait to share it with you tonight. It's about 3 minutes prayer, video about prayer.
It is prayer. Prayer is not sending God to run on your errands. A Christian can see more on his knees than he can from his feet. Prayer is not getting God prepared to do your will. Prayer is getting you prepared to do God's will. Prayer is the only way to release the supernatural power of God in your life, in your marriage, in your business, to show you great and mighty things that you know not. Prayer is the key that unlocks the gates of heaven and closes the gates of hell. Prayer has the power to cure sickness and disease. Prayer can shatter the shackles of misery and habit that are tormenting your life, or the life of your son or daughter, or the life of your husband or wife. Prayer does not need proof. Prayer needs practice. Intellectuals are now jabbering that God and heaven are far removed and far away. God is as close as your next prayer. If your marriage is under attack, pray. If your children are being tormented by the prince of darkness, pray. If your business is failing, pray. If you're fighting a deadly disease, pray. If you're lost and without God, pray. If your life is empty, if it's meaningless, if it seems to be hopeless, pray. Pray, pray, because God answers prayer. A prayerless Christian is a weak Christian. A prayerless Christian is a miserable Christian. A prayerless Christian is a Christian who always lives in defeat. A prayerless church is a weak church. A prayerless family will be a divided family. It has been said and bears saying again, the family that prays together stays together. God expects you every day of the week to pray for the people in your house. Somebody prayed for you. Who are you praying for? Why pray? Because God answers prayer. As powerful as God is, God cannot answer prayer until you pray it. The Bible says, what you bind on earth, I'll bind in heaven. The book of Isaiah says, command ye me. This is God speaking to man, because in prayer, he has given you the authority to launch the initiative. Quit walking around in circles, wringing your hands saying, I wonder when God is going to do something. God in heaven is looking down at you and saying, I have given you the authority of my name. I have given you the power of my word. I have given you the sanctity of my blood. When are you going to use the power that I have given to you to blast the kingdom of hell off at the ground and announce that Jesus Christ is Lord? The initiative rests with you. Asking for things that are impossible, because with God nothing is impossible. Ask him to defeat the giants in your life, because our God is a giant killer. Ask him to divide the sea before you and to bury Pharaoh and watch him turn your enemies into fish food. Ask him to send fire from heaven as he did for Elijah, and he will. Ask him to walk with you in the fire of the fiery furnace and be the fourth man in the fire, and he will. He said you will walk through the fire, and the fire fire will not burn you. You will walk through the water, and the water will not drown you. Ask Him. He's the God who cannot fail. He's waiting to show you great and mighty things. Pray, pray, pray. God in heaven wants you to have that power. Ask according to my infinite power. And God is saying, I want you to ask big. God said, I want you to make me to slide to the edge of my seat and say, wow. Wow, listen to what they're asking for, to move mountains, to heal incurable diseases, to restore dead marriages back to life, to send a financial harvest that their minds cannot fathom. I want you to know God wants to do that.
Amen. So this afternoon when I watched this video, I just remember what pastor in China told me, the more prayer, the more power, the less prayer, the less power, no prayer, no power. So I think maybe you think our SDA church, yeah, we have a lot of truth, we are more truth than Sunday church and other church. Yeah, we know a lot about the Bible. But according to Revelation chapter 3, when you think that you are rich, need nothing, but in God's sight, you are so wretched, miserable, naked, blind. So dear brothers and sisters, I think the problem of the Revelation 3, the church of Revelation 3, one of the big problems is the lack of prayer. Let's kneel down and confess. It's individual time. We invite Jesus come to our heart. Come into our heart. Lord Jesus, we come to you with what we are. Lord, we just ask for your mercy, for your abundant grace. Lord, we know that we are so weak without prayer, that we are so limited without the power of Holy Spirit. Lord, we are just like a branch which has been cut away from the tree. Tonight, Lord, we want to be reconnected with you, with the strength, with the power of Holy Spirit. Lord, be with us in this very moment. Open our eyes so that we can see your glory. Open our ear so that we can be touched by your tender voice. Lord, be with your servant, give him your power, the power from Holy Spirit, that everyone, every corner, be touched by your word. We pray in Jesus' wonderful, precious name. Amen.
Good evening. How was your day?
Very good.
Very good? Always good. I want to give you just a moment to turn to the person next to you and ask them, what did you do with the challenge from last night? Now remember, we had that picture, simple picture. We studied about how Jesus gives us the power to repent, right? Right? And so just ask the person next to you, say, what happened in the last 24 hours between you and Jesus on this matter? And did you pass this news on to somebody else? So I'm just going to give you just a minute to check in. Ask each other with grace, okay? You may have to look behind you in the pew or in front of you. Look around. Okay, are we ready? Does anybody have something to share tonight about what happened in this challenge in the last 24 hours of finding the power in Jesus to turn away from something or to pass this good news on to somebody else? Does anybody have something to share? Dun, 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 dun. Does anybody have anything to share? I don't mind waiting because I want to say something about sharing. We have so much freedom in this country that the issue of testifying about what Jesus is doing is taken for granted. I have been repeatedly sent into countries over the last number of years of my life that don't have the freedom, and so testifying is something that actually is you can actually just almost imagine the fire burning in the church, because people share because they don't know when the next time is that they get to share. So I'm actually impressed right now to do something. It may be uncomfortable, but I'm going to sit down and I'm just going to wait a moment and see. No, really, does anybody have something to share? Is Jesus alive? Tonight, is he alive? Yes. So what's he done in the last 24 hours? And I'm going to be silent for a little bit. And if you have something to share, go right to the point. Remember, testifying, we'll come right here in just a second. Testifying is not about us, it's about who? It's about Jesus Christ. Go ahead.
Zoo, you know, our friend from Zoo, Dylan, and so he comments, I have a new concept of Christ in us and what that means with the power available to let go of my sins. That's what he commented.
Amen. Good. Thank you. Thank you online for sharing. Pardon me?
I have something to share.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Pastor.
Okay. I went back, you know, I went back home, you know, so like, I know this really spoke to me as well, you know, so I prayed to God. I also needed to heart surgery, but very interesting that God brought some situation which really actually revealed what is the inside of your heart. You know, I still remember we went back and as our kids, what would they just all of a sudden, like, and all of a sudden that moment you feel like, okay, oh, I'm at the edge to lose my temper again. So God actually used that situation to remind me that, okay, I truly need a heart surgery. It's not only like I'm just share with others, you know, it's kind of like, okay, I need to work on my end. I woke up at midnight, I said, okay, God, I needed a heart surgery. So I needed to give myself to you and do whatever is necessary. But very interesting that once you want to do that, the situation will come to you like, okay, hey, looks like it. Okay, well, they'll review who you are, you know, like, so I really appreciate that for this is the last 24 hours, you know, so God has been working in my heart, you know, so, and I will continue to seek him for that. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Yvette Jomberg. I'm John's wife. Yesterday was the anniversary of my baptism. For me, that's the best decision that I ever made in my life. It was kind of traumatic because my family did not believe in what I was learning to believe. Then thinking about all of that, what you said last night, and then the anniversary of my baptism is better than my birthday. So I was 14 years old. My family was very upset, and they didn't allow me to go to church for a long time. And then, thanks to a relative who found out what I was going through, my family was subpoenaed, and they had to go to court. They were not abusing me, but this relative was thinking, why are they doing this to her when she just wants to serve God, okay? Then anyway, we went to court, and after talking with the different parties there, the judge that I will never forget ordered my family to allow me to get baptized, I mean to go to church. So I will never forget that judge and the privilege that she gave me to go to church. So my family couldn't do anything because I was a minor. My family had some kind of power in the community, but God used another relative, as I said, to subpoena them, and because of a court order, I was able to go to church. Amen. So I praise God for the privilege. And sometimes we listen to your stories from other countries, but around us, things are going around just kind of similar, not as drastic, but I praise God for allowing me to get to know him. And I'm not a saint. I'm still walking through the process of sanctification, but what a privilege was to meet Christ as my best friend.
By the way, I'm still a work in progress. How many of you are a work in progress? Are you a work in progress? I'm thankful Jesus is patient. Thank you for sharing so much. Anybody else? What's Jesus doing in your life in the last 24 hours? Is he doing anything? Right back here. And then another hand. And then the lady in the red scarf next, okay?
Well, for the freedom that we have to go where we want to do research, you know, someday we might have nothing but propaganda, but now we have the liberty to talk with who we want and to share information.
All right, those are my two kids, and my husband is with Flor and and her pastor. He couldn't come. He's trying to fill some applications for looking for a job. So we came from Ecuador like 2 years ago, and to find a better life. And I decided to come here to the college for my kids to have a very better Christian education. And Lord opened the doors for us, and I'm very happy with that.
What country did you say?
Ecuador. Ecuador, yes.
Is there one last one? Anybody else that has something happen in the last 24 hours? It can be the simplest thing. It doesn't have to be a huge story, but the simplest thing that you know Jesus did something in your life. I know you're hoping, please, Pastor Don, just stop already. Is there one last one? One last one right here. Thank you.
Okay, so I just I want to share something that I have found very interesting. So before the revival started, I was having a really hard time at work, a really, really, really hard time. For various reasons, and I cannot go into details. And then I got to the point where the revival was about to start, And I started wondering, why am I having so many interpersonal conflicts with my coworkers? And it's like God opened my eyes that the enemy wanted to create problems so that I wouldn't want to be involved in this revival or participate in things, because I would be in the spirit of like bitterness and being upset. And ever since the revival started, or just about, yeah, this week so far, the whole week, I have had some of the best days at work. Amen. And I've been thinking and praying, and I'm just like, I'm about to transition to leave this job because of multiple reasons, but one of them was the interpersonal conflicts. And tomorrow I have an interview, and I'm like, do I really want to leave now? That's how nice it's been this week. And I just really want to praise God, and I just really also want to ask for prayer, because I want to be where God wants me to be, and I just really want his will. So I'm really grateful, because God opened my eyes to see that, you know what, the devil always wants to create problems and distract us from being unified. And so forget about that and just focus on what God is saying now.
Please open your Bibles to Revelation 3:20. Revelation 3:20. And Revelation 3:20, please read this one text with someone next to you. Look around you. Make sure everybody has somebody to read with. So if someone's by themselves, go across the aisle. We are still free to do that, right? Okay, so go across the aisle if someone's by themselves, or go to another pew. But we need to practice the fellowship of believers tonight. Amen? Amen. That was just one amen from Chris. Thank you, Chris. But amen?
Amen.
Okay, so look around you. Everybody find somebody. Revelation 3:20, and here's the question. What does this tell you about Jesus? And where is Jesus tonight based on Revelation 3:20? Check it out. We'll check back in about a minute and a half. Anything you can find about Jesus. Get ready to compare notes about what this tells us about Jesus. I need one person to come up and be an artist tonight. You don't have to be a fancy artist, just a simple artist. I just need something depicted up here. It's not hard to draw, I promise. So would someone come up real quick that's willing to draw? You willing? Come on up. Okay. Okay, are you ready, everybody? What was that? Okay, that's better. I want to make sure you're alive and kicking. And Revelation 3:20 says, Jesus is talking, right? Jesus is talking. And he says, behold, I stand at the what? At the door and knock. So if you can draw a door, but somewhere in the middle of the picture, and then draw where is Jesus, and then draw where are we as an end time people. And just be thinking with me about this. I have always been raised saying that this is a beautiful thing that Jesus is saying in verse 20. recently I've decided that it's actually not so good. What do you think about that? In other words, I was raised saying, oh, isn't it nice that Jesus is at the door and he's knocking? And that's the way I've been raised as a little kid. And I grew up and all the way to Southern University right here, Adventist University. All that time I thought, oh, Jesus is standing at the door knocking. I love it that he's knocking at my door. Awesome. But question tonight, where is Jesus? Outside. He's outside. That's the point. And this letter from Jesus, it's Jesus' last love letter to his last people. He's saying to people like you and me, Pastor Don, put your own name in there. He's saying to you and me, I'm outside the door. And really where I want to be, what does the rest of the text say? What does he want to be? He wants to be inside with us doing what? Look closely. Eating a meal. By the way, I love that this church practices the fellowship of believers. I'm serious. Not only is it fun to eat food at this church, but it's important to fellowship together. Amen? Jesus is not satisfied being outside your heart's door tonight, knocking and knocking and knocking and knocking. He would like to be in deep fellowship. He'd like to be at the table. If you can draw a table with Jesus and us, if you feel brave, just draw a table, because Jesus wants to be at the table, right? Right at the table. Now, when I was on the island of Vanuatu, have any of you been on the island of Vanuatu? Anybody? I have to confess that before I was invited to go there, I didn't know it existed. So when they invited me to go there and do training, I was like, where? Exactly, where did you want me to go? And Vanuatu is actually many, many islands. And on that island, I found out something very interesting as soon as I landed. Some of these big, big men that grew up and were raised there, I came up to them, and of course, this was way before the pandemic. You could actually shake hands back in that time. You remember those days? Okay, long ago. But I reached out my hand, and I said, oh, and what's your name? And this big, huge guy that was like two or three of me put together, powerful guy. And he said, John. I said, what was that? This big, huge guy. And I said, my name is Don. What's your name? And I found out that this was an island of whisperers. I'm serious. Big, huge guys that look like they could be wrestlers or I would say, and hello, my name is Pastor Don. What's your name? It's good to meet you. And they would say, Henry. I said, what was that? Henry. You know, Henry. I'm serious. I was like, whoa. At first, I thought it was just like one or two guys, and then it was like more and more and more and more and more. I mean, and then I watched one time over lunch as we were having a fellowship meal down here, and then there was like these apartments here right around the training, and so there was like women right up here in a balcony, maybe about 60 feet apart from women over in a balcony over here, 60 feet apart, okay, and or 70, and they were whispering to each other. I'm serious, and they were having a full conversation, and they weren't like, "Hey, Sally, how's it going?" No, they were like, and I was watching this, and I said, how do they do it? I had 1 week of hearing only whispers. Hardly anybody ever, like, they didn't raise their voice, except for one time. And it wasn't anger. It was when they sang. It was like, whoosh, it just came alive. I mean, just like, whoa, like the whole island was just flooded with singing. Thank you for this. Thank you. Let's give her a hand. Thank you very much for the artwork. Jesus is at the door, but he wants to sit. What? Look at this. She's got like a lot of us here at the table with Jesus. Thank you for that. Thank you. But you know, at that place was awesome is that when I talked to them about hearing the voice of God, they got it in a way that probably I, the teacher, didn't get it because they were used to listening. On that island, they really, really listen. And they carry whole conversations on all through the day that way. I wonder, look with me at verse 20. Look at it closely. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone, what? Hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and he will dine with him and he with me. In Revelation, it says that Jesus' voice is like the sound of many rushing waters. Do you want to hear his voice like that in heaven someday soon? Do you want to hear his voice? Like really hear it like audibly. Isn't it going to be awesome when we hear his voice like that? Many rushing waters? I think that's going to be awesome, awesome. But Jesus wants us to hear his voice even now. Like right now. Does Jesus still speak? Does he still talk? Absolutely he does. And he's crying out to his people in this end of time. He says, I'm on the other side of the door. That's the problem. He's out here, and he's knocking on the other side. And he's wanting us to open the door. You know, this should be humbling to me and to you tonight. Because no matter how long you know you and I have been coming to church, how long we've been bearing the name of Jesus Christ, Jesus says to people just like you and me, he says to us tonight, I'm still outside the door compared with what fellowship I want with you. Jesus wants to sit down at the table with you and me. And he wants us not to try to impress him. He wants us just to say, come on in. In Vanuatu, one night, after I'd been there several nights, a man came up to me very, very shyly. And of course, to me, everybody seemed shy. And he said to me very, very quietly, he said, would you like to come to my home tonight? And again, he said it way softer than that. That's my attempt at talking softly. And I said, what? And he said, would you like to come to my home tonight? I said, sure, I would like to visit. And he said, well, come. And he was so excited. He said, I've been building a home for my family. And so he said, I would like you to come and bless our home. And so he said, I have to start walking now. He said, do you have more training? And he says, I have to start walking now so I can get there and tell my family to be ready for you to come. And so yeah, he probably walked a couple hours. I don't know. And I finished the rest of the day. And that evening, they got me a ride. And we went out through the night, bumping along out across Vanuatu. It was way out in the middle of nowhere. And I saw so many people walking along the road, just like I saw in Zambia, where I just came from just about 14 nights ago or so. I was just in Zambia, way out in the middle of nowhere, in a remote part of Zambia. I saw lots of people walking there too. But anyway, so I get along there, and all of a sudden, my driver said, Pastor Don, he said, I think this is where that family lives. And I looked through the darkness, and there's no lights or anything. I said, how do you know? He said, I just know. He's someone who lived there. I just know. It's about right here. He said, you're going to need a flashlight. So I got a flashlight, and I'm picking my way off of the road down in through the jungly little area right there, and I'm going along, and I see a little tiny little bit of light through the darkness. And pretty soon I hear a voice out of the darkness say, Pastor Don, are you coming to visit? I said, yes, but I don't know where you are. And then I heard again this voice, you're coming the right way, keep coming this way. And so I followed that little light and I followed his voice, I was listening for that voice. And finally I came up to the home that he was so excited to share with me. The home was probably about from this corner to about here and to the wall, well, a little bit wider, but you know, like maybe 10 by 10 or something. He had a big family in that home and he had a little blanket that was for the door, and he swept the blanket aside, and the family stood there, and they were so excited. They said, you're coming to visit our home. I said, yes, I am. And so they said, and they had mats on the floor, and they said, this is our bed. They had little grass mats, and they said, here's a grass mat, and they opened it up like that, and they said, here, would you please sit with us? And I sat with them, and I felt like I was in the most precious, precious home in the world. I did. The presence of God was there. It was a humble place. It was a quiet place, so peaceful. I could hear the crickets all around. And the children very proudly sang songs and repeated scripture to me. And they talked about Jesus. And they said, will you talk to us about Jesus? Would you bless our home? Would you bless our children in the name of Jesus Christ? And I looked around, not wanting to stare, but everything was so simple. But you know what? I loved it that they said, here's a mat, sit with us. Not let us go to a neighbor and try to find a chair for this guy that came from the United States. No, sit with us. And I picture Jesus in these last days, he's saying, I want you to invite me in and come in with what you've got going on. I want to come in to your dorm room. I want to come in to the place where you live in the country or the city or, you know, whatever it is. I want to live in your hut. I want to live in your mansion. Whatever is your reality, I want to come in and fellowship with you and eat with you, says Revelation 3, verse 20. Are we tracking together or not? Jesus does not want us to try to impress him when we go to the door and say, come in, Jesus. He doesn't want us to say, hold on right here. Let me go and get the best china. Oh, excuse me, Jesus. I don't have quite the food that maybe you would want. He wants us to fling the door open, even tonight, and say, just come on in. And tonight, Jesus, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic, I'm making a point. Tonight, Jesus, if we have beans, we have beans. Come in and enjoy beans. You know what I'm saying? And Jesus, if what I have is paper plates, then sit down with me and enjoy eating on paper plates. That's what I'm doing. Just come in and fellowship. I'm not going to try to impress you, Jesus. I just want you to come in and be with me. Jesus tells us in his word, if you go to Revelation 14, check this out. Revelation 14. It says what kind of relationship his people are going to have in these end of time. In Revelation 14, tell me when you're there. And it talks about these ones living in these last days. And it says this in verse 4. These are the ones who have not been defiled with women, for they've kept themselves chaste. These are the ones who follow the Lamb. Where? Wherever he goes. Wherever he goes. These have been purchased from among men as first fruits of God and to the Lamb. God is looking for a people that will open the door wide to Jesus and sit down and let him fellowship with you right in whatever is going on in your life. And he loves to do that, to come into our world and not leave us the same way that he found us. We talked about Mary Magdalene last night. Hallelujah for that. That Mary Magdalene became a transformed woman. Absolutely. The fellowship of Jesus is precious, end time message for his people. Don't minimize it. How many of you are going through turbulent times right now in one way or another? You don't have to say what they are, but are you going through turbulent times, like rocky times, tough times? Anybody tonight? Oh, think about this message for you tonight. Look at it very closely again with me, and then I want to tell you just a few stories. Revelation 3:20, just look at it closely. Again, Revelation 3, verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone, oh, I like that word, anyone. Could that be talking about you tonight? Amen. If you raise your hand tonight and you're going through a rough time, is it talking about you when it says if anyone? Yes, absolutely. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. I love that Jesus fellowships with his people. He walks with his people. Go with me to Revelation 1. Revelation 1. Notice where Jesus is in these last days. Revelation 1, verse 12. Tell me when you're there, just say amen. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the middle of the lampstands, I saw one like a son of man, clothed in a robe, reaching to the feet, and girded around his chest with a golden sash. Who is this one walking among, or I should say, in the middle of the lampstands? Is Jesus Christ like a son of man? He is a son of man. Okay, we might say, well, that's nice. That's nice that he's among the lampstands. But what big deal is that for me as a busy student at Southern or as a young adult here or older adult here? What's the big deal about Jesus being there among the lampstands? Look at verse 20. As for the mystery of the seven stars, which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So where is Jesus in these last days? He's among the churches. And he's among the church. And who's the church? Oh, say it louder.
We are.
We are the church. So Jesus Christ, even if you're having a rocky day today, a tumultuous time in this time of pandemic, no matter what your situation is, Jesus is there with you. This is part of Jesus' last love letter, and he wants his people to know how present he is, how accounted he is for his people. But look at also, this one, just turn to the person next to you, read chapter 2, verse 1, just verse 1 out loud with a person next to you, find out what else it says about Jesus and where he is in relationship to you. Just check it out, read it out loud with a person next to you. Where is Jesus tonight, based on chapter 2, verse 1? Where is he? Is he sitting? Is he standing? Is he looking from afar off? What is he doing? He's walking among his people. Now, tonight, he's walking where you walk. He's staying where you stay. He's very present right now for his people. Who needs this message tonight? We all need it tonight. Let me tell you, I say this from my heart to you tonight. I know the presence of Jesus when I have been on the other side of the planet and I've been hunted because I was not supposed to be in that country according to the law of the land. I know what it's like to be searched for, but not so that I can preach, but so that I can be imprisoned for the gospel of Jesus. And I know the power of Jesus to be with his people. I know what it's like. I know what it's like when believers grabbed me by the wrist and said, come with us now, because they're coming for you now. I know what it's like to be stuffed into a room. I said, Pastor Don, do not answer this door unless if we personally come and find you. I know what it's like to be in the dark, waiting, not 1 minute, but for an hour or 2 hours, and waiting, wondering if the next one that comes through is the one that's looking for me, that I hope doesn't find me, or is it the believer that comes and says it's okay? Now you can go and come back and train us some more. And there is a fellowship with Jesus that I have found, that Jesus, when he says, I am with you always, it is true. Did my heart thump in that time? Oh, you better believe it. But you know what? There's also a surety in knowing that when Jesus says, I am with you always, even to the end of the age, he is there. And you know that finally, there was a knock at the door, and my heart leaped, and I went running to the door. I had a couple believers in that room, and they said, oh, do not answer that door yet. That's not the right signal. And they stuffed me into a tinier, tinier room, about this big, little cubbyhole. And they locked the door, and they said, you do not make a sound until we come and get you. I will tell you, no matter where you're stuffed, no matter where you are, no matter what kind of hell you might be going through, Jesus is there with you. Isaiah 43 says what? When you are in the waters, I am there with you. When you're with the fires, I am there with you. You'll not be burned. He says, I'll be with you all the time. And finally, that door did open, and it was believers. And I said, can I get out of here now? I was so tired of being in that little place. And they said, yes. And they said, let's tell you what happened. And they looked me in the eye and they said, this is what happened. Right at the stroke of, I think it was 9 o'clock in the morning, they said, the people looking for you came and searched the room. They came in with all the insignia, everything that represents the power of this certain country. They came marching in, and they scanned the room looking for me because I was a foreigner, which was not supposed to be there, and certainly not sharing Jesus in this place. And as their eyes swept the room looking for someone that would stand out and look different than the rest, me, you know, a foreigner, all of a sudden, with all the pomp and power that they had, looking like this, just sweeping through, all of a sudden, the believers told me later that they fixed their eyes on something, somebody in the back of the room, and then their face went white, both of them, and they turned on their heel and went out of there as fast as they could go, like they were scared to death of what was in the room. Who was in the room? I was far away in that big old crazy monstrosity of a building that I was in. I was way stuffed into a little room, but who was also in that big room where that was happening? Jesus was there through the power of the Holy Spirit. His angels were there. And he terrified the ones who came up against him. I can look you in the eye and tell you that during this pandemic, in March 10, when April and I lived in Canada, when I hugged and kissed my wife goodbye, and our youngest daughter was still home there, I went on the other side of the planet to the Philippines to call for revival. And I went all the way there, and I said, April, I'll be back, and I think it was, 14 days I was supposed to be back, 12 or 14 days. And we said, great, but you know what was happening March 10? Can you remember what was happening about right then? So a few people said, actually a lot of people said, should you be going right now? I said, all I know is God said to go. So I follow my master commander. Amen? We have to follow a master commander. By the way, I have not always done that. I have many times played it safe in my life. How about you? Just being real tonight, I played it safe too many times. And now's the time to risk for Jesus Christ. Risk in every way, as long as it's according to the word of God. And so the Holy Spirit told me, no, go there and to go to AUP, Adventist University of the Philippines. It has, I don't know, counting all the little kids all the way up, it's maybe 4,000 students, something like that. And they said, we want a revival. Praise God. I get there. 2 days later, the gates on the big campus shut on me. On me. I'm inside. And I'm still saying, oh, no problem. Okay, according to my schedule, my calendar, I will be going home on my flight in just a few days. So I really wasn't that worried about it. I had the revival, and it went pretty rough because instead of 4,000 in the audience that were all excited and everything, the government was giving very heavy, heavy regulations, and people were afraid to come to the revival because of the pandemic. Are you with me tonight? People didn't want to, they didn't want to be around each other. Everybody's scared that they're going to get something, of course. And finally, it came up to the end of the revival, and I told the students on campus, I said, I'll stay a day or two, and then I'll fly home. And then my flight canceled. Oh, that's strange. Well, I'm not worried. And then I got another flight. My friends in Canada said, we're going to get you out of there. We will get you out. And I said, great. And I went all the way to the airport. Doctor got me through military checkpoints. He stuffed me in the back of his car and had tinted windows. And he said, because I have a white coat on and they know me, I'm going to just take you right to the airport. We're going to get you back home, no problem. And we went flying through the checkpoints. They just waved him on. And he said, don't show your face. We'll just get you out of here. So I go all the way to the airport, and it's like Manila, huge airport. How many of you have been in Manila? Manila, can barely say it. And I get there, and it's quiet as a tomb. I'm still not catching on. I'm thinking, great, I'm going to just have no lines, great. I go up there, and I show my passport and everything, and I said, I'm excited about going home, sir. And they said, great. And they said, they put in the ticket, and they said, And finally they said, sorry, sir, as of just a couple hours ago, this ticket is no longer valid. When's your next ticket? I said, when's your next flight? And he looked at me and he had a hard time saying it. Well, sir, I don't know how to tell you this, but probably not until July. I said, that was a good one. That was a good joke. No, he said, I'm serious. No. That's your next flight, probably July. I said, sir, this is March. He said, I know, and you have a problem. I said, yes, I do. I said, what would you recommend? I said, I have no recommendations for you to get out of Philippines at this time. You know, 11 times I had my flights canceled. I ended up, instead of being there 12 days, I was there almost 3 months. 3 months. April and Jess were up there in Western Canada, and I was hearing reports about food getting harder to get and different things up where we were and all kinds of crazy stuff. You know, you don't know what's factor, you know, right? Or fiction when you're on the other side of the planet. And I found something. In the early mornings, I would go out into the fields in desperation after being out in the Word. I said, God, I don't understand what's going on. How can I get home? How can I get home? I want to be with my family and keep them safe and do my part as a husband and as a daddy to our children. And finally, that still small voice of Jesus, the one who knocks at your heart's door and my heart's door, he said, you know what? He said, you are where you're supposed to be. I sent you here. And that still small voice of God told me, because I actually got a ticket that looked like it was going to work, and he said, cancel. This one I want you to cancel yourself. Cancel your way home. I said, this may be my only way home. Some people were saying, you may not even get home for a year. And he said, cancel it. Trust me on this. You have a work to do in the Philippines. You are where you're supposed to be in this end of time right now. I said, but when do I get home? Not your business when you get home. I'm just telling you straight out. My friends, if you and I are not listening to the still small voice of God now, we will miss our instructions. And I'm telling you this just the way it was. And I wrestled. I wish I could look you in the eye and say it was no wrestling match for me. I just said, oh, yes, Lord, no problem. But I had to wrestle with God. I had to wrestle with him. Are you wrestling with God on anything? Let him win. Surrender to him. Invite him to come in. And during those weeks that turned into months, I saw the hand of God like I've never seen ever before in my entire life in ministry. Students came up and they said, well, since you are stuck here, why don't you train us to be disciples and disciple makers? I said, praise God, that's what I love to do. Well, they said, then start doing it. I said, when do you want to meet? They said, that's the only problem. They said, most of us are working students. We're working 40 hours a week. We're also trying to take classes. And now everything's online. And so we're busy in the night trying to study. And we're busy during the day either working or trying to do studies. The only time we can give you is 6 a.m. Would you actually come? Oh, yes, they said. We're hungry. And so they came out again and again, 6 a.m. They said, teach us how to live as a disciple. Teach us how to be a disciple maker. The weeks turned into months. Sometimes I saw students standing like a snake out under, like you know what I'm saying, a winding long snake waiting for food. Things got tough on campus. People repeatedly looked at me and they said, with all due respect, with your white face, if they have a problem in Manila and they start climbing over the walls, they're going to look for people like you and they're going to think you're super wealthy. You know, you're going to be in trouble. And they're going to get you. You need to get home. I said, I've been trying to get home. And God kept on saying, still, be quiet. You're where you're supposed to be. And finally, in the last few days that I was there, of almost 90 days, an atheist had been standing at the back day after day, week after week, listening as students, not so much listening, he listened to me, but what moved his heart was students started coming up and saying, this is who Jesus is in my life. And he was struck by the fact that students that he knew bore the name of Christian, but were not living as a Christian, now were treating people with kindness and respect, and they were living differently. And finally, this young man, who is noted across the entire campus as someone who could take down any Christian, by the way, with his intellect, he could just slice you down to where you would say, I don't know what else to say to testify about Jesus. You just took away all my arguments. He's that kind of guy. He raised his hand 2 days before I left, and he came up, and some of the students were saying, Pastor Don, don't have him go to the mic. No, we have new believers here. We have people coming to Christ. He's against Christ. And the Spirit of God said, have him come up. And people were like this. I could see their knuckles. They were like this. They're saying, no, don't do it. Don't have him come up. He slowly made his way up here, a very proud young man, but this time he looked different. He grabbed the microphone and people were like, okay, here it comes. He's going to start cursing or swearing at Jesus or you or whatever. And he said, I have watched you day after day, week after week during this pandemic. You are not the same students that I've been going to school with year after year. He said, I hate to say it, but you have not impressed me with your lifestyle. I am an avowed atheist, he said. And he said, my father was an atheist, or is an atheist. He said, I've watched you for all these years, because by the way, it takes them a long time to go through school, working students, you know, maybe some 8 years, 10 years to go through, okay? He said, I've watched you year after year, and there's nothing compelling about what's going on with you and Jesus until now. And now I can't get around the fact that you have changed. And I watch how you treat me as an atheist on this campus, and I have to wonder why. I used to watch you as you go to church and then come back, and I watch what you do on your phones and with your video games and with whatever, you know what I'm saying, dot, 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 on and on and on and on. And he said, I have not been impressed. There's nothing that you have that I want up until just the last few months of my life. And he said, now, he said, I need to go public and tell you that today I choose Jesus. And everybody just about fell over. And he said, Jesus is going to be who I'm going to follow. And he said, as soon as those doors open, I'm going home to my daddy. And I'm going to tell him, Dad, I love you and respect you, but you never told me about the one who can change my life. And I have found him. He said, pray for me because I am going to call my father to know his true father. Tonight, Jesus is knocking at our heart's door. He says, even to the most spiritual person among us, whoever that is, he says, I'm outside the door compared with where I want to be. I want to be sitting at the table. I want to be right there with you through whatever stuff you're going through. I want to fellowship with you in thick and thin, hard times and good times. I want to be there with you. If your answer is yes to him, then just come up. Come up as you hear a song. Do we have a song tonight? And as she shares that song, just come up and have that prayer between you and Jesus Christ.
Spills over, music fills the night. contain your joy inside. And dance for Jesus. And dance for Jesus. And dance for Jesus. And live. With your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodnight. Rest in peace and sleep until he comes. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus.
In this quiet place, if there's anyone in this worship room that has been putting Jesus off at arm's length, even while you've been bearing his name, even while you've been doing good things in his name, but if you know you've been putting him off, I invite you just to come right up here. And I'm just going to I'm just kneeling here in the middle, and I'm going to pray. And if there's any person that knows that Jesus is talking to you tonight, and you're tired of keeping him outside arm's length. You want him to sit at your table. You want him to fellowship with you in the deepest way. You're hungry, thirsty for this kind of fellowship with Jesus Christ. Then just come up right where you are. Just come up. I'll just pause just one moment and then I'm going to pray. If that's you, just come up. Be unafraid to give a signal to heaven by coming up if that's your need tonight. Dear God in heaven, many, many times I have been too rushed for you. Maybe there's others in this room that have done the same thing. And I've enjoyed being in the Word with you in the morning, but maybe been too busy with my own agenda during the day. And God, I know I've disappointed you many times. Thank you, though, for still knocking at my heart's door. Thank you for knocking at our heart's door tonight. Thank you for reaching out to every one of us here and also our friends online. And you say, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And even though you're on the outside in these last days, you are whispering to your people, don't you know my voice? I'm calling. I want to come in. I want to have a fellowship with you deeper than your deepest friend on earth. That's what you're offering us tonight. So God, no matter what we're going through, the happiest times, the worst of times, times when we have lots of friends surrounding us laughing or all alone, you offer a fellowship that is closer than a brother, the best brother we can imagine. You are with us in the most lonely times, the harshest times, the most dangerous times, the most dark times. You say, I am with you always. I am with you always to the end of the age. God, I pray that you would press in close with your presence to every one of us tonight, because there's nothing like the presence of Jesus to bring revival in our hearts in these last days. Help us to know your presence according to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Your invitation over the next 24 hours, my friend, is fellowship with Jesus. Read Revelation 3:20. Enjoy him. Enjoy him beyond the way you've been enjoying him in the past. Enjoy him in prayer. Enjoy him in the word. God bless you. And Pastor?
Thank you very much. Another very beautiful night. Are you blessed? Are you? Okay, I know that Jesus is still outside and knocking at the door, you know, so a lot of time we're too busy with our own agenda. And I just want to encourage you tonight, you know, so in the next 24 hours, as Pastor Dom challenged us, let's just listen carefully and incline your ear to the knocking. And let's just open the door and let God to just step into our loom and we can experience something. And I'm sure the next 24 hours will be something very special, very different for you if you wanted to do it. I want to do it. So I hope that, and I really appreciate it. Pastor Don always like pray to God, ask God to wake him up and to remind him of his appointment, his date with God. And I would encourage you tonight, and we can probably say the similar prayer. Ask God to wake you up in the night or early in the morning. And you really needed to spend some quality time with him. And I do believe when you do that, your day will be different. Friends, and this is a day, let's just march to the freedom. And I know God is working in our hearts. So let's just bring more friends to join us. Tomorrow and the day after tomorrow will be the 2 day left. 2 day left, you know. So we are going to have a closing night on 30. So I would encourage you to join us. The time will be a little bit different, not 7. We'll start at 6. So please join us. And our Saps evening, that will be the day of closing. So please be with us. Okay, thank you for coming. And I would like to thank whoever joined us online. And we do have some Chinese friends join us online. And so I just want to welcome you. And it looks like they still have a little bit issues, like they will not be able to hear something. And I hope, I will pray. And so welcome Lisa. Okay, welcome Lisa is from Shanghai. And she's joining us here tonight. We are so happy to have you with us. You know, so, okay, God bless you. And I hope and with more friends can join us. So we still have some light meal tonight, you know, waiting for you. And so let's just go to the fellowship hall. And so we can have more time if you wanted to talk with Pastor Don or and April or Donnie. And so, and you feel free to join us. Okay, so thank you. And so where's Brian? Brian? Oh, can you lead us to the fellowship hall? Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. God bless you. Have a great night.